أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلله فلا هادي له ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له ونشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وسلم قال الله في القرآن الكريم بعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم يا أيها الذين آمنوا قوا أنفسكم وأهليكم نارا صدق الله العظيم. الله سبحانه وتعالى says in his noble Quran, he says, O you who believe, Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu, O you who lay claim that you believe, Qu anfusahum, protect yourselves, Wa ahlikum, and your families from the fire. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has set this as an imperative. This is in a command form, that this is one of the priorities of every Muslim. Now, there's a lot of YouTube sheikhs out there, a lot of internet, you know, very well known ulama. And this is the ayah, isn't it? You know, this is the one. This is the one that, in brackets, what we're actually saying in parentheses is, just worry about yourself and stay at home, work on your kids. This is the one. Now, Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, radiallahu anhu, very, very early on, he had to put a stop to this. You see, he was at the minbar and he was giving the khutbah. And the first thing he said, and this is an authentic narration, he said in Medina, he said, O people, you read the following verse, and this is another verse but a very similar meaning, O you believe, take care of your own selves. He says, you read this ayah, but you don't understand it correctly. Very early, you understand, most of the deviances that happened in Islam, the signs of those started early in the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, even after his death. So this idea of, oh, I think I'll leave struggling for Islam, we live comfortably within Islam now, I don't need to live for Islam anymore, I just need to live by Islam. By Islam, yani, you eat Islam, you watch Islam channel, you sleep Islam, you know, you basically do everything in terms of your physical, you know, your instincts, you satisfy them Islamically. You don't have to worry about anything else. So even this mentality started to set in at that time. And the Prophet Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu, he said, you have not understood this ayah correctly. So he nipped this in the bud very early amongst the Muslims. He said, I have heard the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam say that if the people witness the abominable, the perversion of the deen, the oppression of Muslims, the usurpation of Muslim lands, you know, the attack on Islam, when the abominable thing that happens, the fitna that happens amongst the Muslims, and the Muslims do not address it, we would be nigh to on them all a severe torment. Nigh on them means basically that we would be deserving a massive punishment. And this, in this hadith, when it talks about it, it doesn't discuss the pious ones. It's everybody. When the Muslims abandoned enjoining good, forbidding the evil, when they abandoned their many responsibilities that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put on them. What are these responsibilities? They happen within various spheres, my brothers and sisters. A Muslim, he has his own vessel as an individual. That is sphere number one. He is within his family. That is another sphere that he exists in. There's a third sphere, which is within his community and his neighbor. Do our neighbors not have rights upon us? Does our community not have any relationship with us? And the fourth is the ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They have rights over us, brothers. So when we want to purify ourselves, or when we want to practice Islam, when we want to struggle for Islam, any of these things happen within the context in those spheres. because we exist in all of them. You are inseparable from those spheres. You cannot be taken out. You can't say, I'm a community, not part of the ummah. It's just family and me, not part of the community. You exist in all of these things, my brothers and sisters. And we will be accountable for all of these things. So I want to kind of just give you like a broad outset before I start going into some detail. Now, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is mentioned an ayah, a very specific ayah that was a came as a grave warning to the Sahaba radiallahu anhum and the non-Muslims of that time. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala it says, بعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم يوم يفر المرء من أخيه وأمه وأبيه وصاحبته وبنيه لكل امرئ منهم يومئذ شأن يغنيه. This verse came and it put a firm warning on the Muslims that on the Day of Judgment, that though in this dunya, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَاتَّصِمُوا بِاللَّهِ جَمِيعًا, yeah, the hold onto the rope of Allah, بِحَبْلِ اللَّهِ جَمِيعًا, and do not divide amongst yourselves, that we cannot get to Jannah without each other, without our children, without our parents, without our community, without ummah. You can't get to Jannah that way. You don't climb up this rope, and you kick your brother down, and you're climbing, you say, look, I'm busy. You know, it's dog, dog. It doesn't work like that. In this dunya, you work for akhirah through each other as a community, as an ummah. But on that day, يَوْمَ لَا تَمْلِكُ نَفْسٌ لِنَفْسٍ شَيْئًا, that day no soul can help another soul and free him. So brothers and sisters, we work together here. We don't try to divide. And on that day, we will be assessed individually. So in this ayah, يَوْمَ يَفِرُّ الْمَرْءُ مِنْ أَخِيهِ, the day the man will run away from his brother. وَأُمِّهِ وَأَبِيهِ, and he was run away from who? His mother and his father. وَصَاحِبَتِهِ وَبَنِيهِ, and he will run away from his wife and his children. Subhanallah, you know children, when they get scared, usually, they'd hide behind their dad. Or maybe if there's some nutcase on the street, some drunk nutcase, your wife would probably, you know, say, I'll just stay behind you for a moment. Yeah, you deal with that, okay? Can you imagine that the man, everybody's fleeing from each other, family members. So we understand that I'm trying to do this where I disconnect you and then reconnect you. You understand? That we don't connect just because like animals we have instincts towards our children. Because if we could rely on that, we would not need Hidayah. We would not need Islam. And look at what we have a situation with how children are. How many people have difficulties within the family home, within the structure of the family. Because everything is abandoned in the society. Everybody is an individual. Everybody, even at home, is an individual. The son is looking at his screen, father is looking at his screen, the wife is looking at her channel. Everybody's separate, even though they're in the same house. There is no fusion in that family. There's no unity in that family. Everybody's separate. Now, when you have everybody separate like that, what do you expect how that's going to transfer into society? So this is the mentality that we have around us, and this absolute failure and collapse of the family unit. Children do not respect their parents. Students don't respect their teachers. No one respects anybody. The young do not respect the old. All of these bonds and all of these links, the sanctity of these links have been separated due to individualism. So what we want to do is we want to look at some of the ayat and some of the evidences. So in this ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, لِكُلِّ امْرِئٍ مِّنْهُمْ يَوْمَئِذٍ شَأْنٌ يُغْنِي. Yeah, يُغْنِي, it means that every single person will be free from the other person of need because they can't help each other. So I wanted to kind of maybe just make your eyes dilate, wake up a bit, you know, first to really give you a mild warning, and then maybe inshallah go into some of the details. Now, I want to just share with you some of the sources so that it's not a magic trick, you know, it's not a rabbit out of a hat. I've got to give you some idea of where I've got some of the understanding of how you raise your children. I myself, I've got three children and I've had some experience from that. I also, obviously, I'm a son of somebody, invariably. So I've had experiences as I've grown up from my own parents. I've studied various books on parenting. And I've studied like parenting with some of the shuyukh as well, namely Sheikh Akram Nadwi, in relation to this subject. But the greatest experience I had in knowing about parenting is dealing with your kids, not yours specifically, we don't know each other yet. But I've been dealing with youth for 15 years, roughly 15 years. Day in, day out with, you know, with youth clubs, with events, with this and that. They've been in my house for about 5 years for every Saturday, stay over and all this stuff. And I faced many difficulties with the brothers, you know, it's like a rehabilitation center, right? But every problem, when I thought about my kids, I thought, how am I going to teach them? I realized that I need to use my source material. I've got 15 years of experience of dealing with youth. And most of those problems, when I reverse engineer those things, when I go backwards and find out what is the initial source of the good quality in that person. I even interviewed brothers I like. I said, how did you end up like you were? You know, and then I would interview them. I literally go meet them up and ask them, how was your home life? How did your parents teach you? Did they travel abroad? What did they do with you? How many teachers did you have? How many hours did you study? Did they let you play? Did you feel alone? You know, did you feel like separate from other kids because you, you know, I asked them every question I could think of. But the experience actually came from working out from the da'wah, from practical experience, that most of the problems that the youth have in terms of, let's say, vaccinating them from some of the problems that they face later on and some of the habits that they cannot give up, some of the deeply ingrained mentalities that are there, was from parenting. So parenting, my brothers and sisters, is a major, major issue in the revival of this deen. You lose your children, what are you doing? Just think about it. If you lose your children, where is the deen? Mashallah, I like to think that everybody here calls people to Islam, to give da'wah, calls to it as a comprehensive way of life and such and such. I'd like to think that. But if you lose your children, you have lost. So really what we need to think about is this specific, you know, this is a 15-year, 20-year project. This isn't a 1-year campaign. This is a 20-year project. This is a 17-year project. You need to think about this very, very clearly. So, I will begin with the main hadith that, you know, mentioned mas'uliyah wa ri'ayah, meaning to be responsible and to be someone who shepherds or someone who reins people in. The hadith narrated ruya anhu Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam أنه قال حديث is ألا كلكم راع وكلكم مسؤول عن رعيته فالأمير الذي على الناس راع وهو مسؤول عنهم والرجل راع على أهل بيته وهو مسؤول عنهم والمرأة راعية على بيت بعلها وولده وهي مسؤولة عنهم والعبد راع على سيدي على مال سيدي وهو مسؤول عنه فكلكم راع وكلكم مسؤول عن رعيته. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, and this gives you a very clear understanding about what a Muslim is. He said, every single person, every single one of you, and you know, he says ala kullukum. This means, is it not obvious? It's taqeed, this emphasis. Is it not obvious that every single one of you is mas'ulun? Mas'ul means to be responsible. Sometimes they have it as a manager or someone who's in charge of something. That's what we call mas'ul. But mas'ul has two meanings. One meaning in the dunya and one meaning in the akhirah. The meaning in the dunya is you're the person who's asked. I want to do this X, Y, and Z. Boss, I need to do this. I need to do this event. I need to do this. You talk to the boss man. He's the mas'ul. Okay? He is the maf'ul of that. Meaning the one who is asked. Mas'ul. But it also means in the akhirah, the one who will be asked. Meaning that he will be asked on his ri'ayah. He will be asked about his management. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that the believer, he will come in chains of any believer who was mas'ul, who was in charge of 10 people or more. For 10 people or more, he will be in chains until every single one of the people underneath him release him from his, you know, whether he dealt with them justly, whether he was fair or not. So this is what the hadith is saying. فَالْأَمِيرُ الَّذِي عَلَى النَّاسِ رَاعٍ وَهُوَ مَسْؤُولٌ عَنْهُمْ, meaning that the Amir over the people, all of you, your family, your community, and the individual. He is ra'in, and we will deal with this right at the end, inshallah. وَالرَّجُلُ ra'in ala ahli baytihi, and the man is a mas'ul over what? He is mas'ul over, he's a ra'in over his family, over the people of his house, meaning that he provides for the house and what's in that house, his family. وَمَسْؤُولٌ anhum, and he is will be questioned, and he's the one who's questioned. You know, when something is needed, some shopping is needed, some requirement clothes for the children, he's the one who is going to be asked. وَالْمَرْأَةُ رَاعِيَةٌ. So the women are not exempt from this. They are included in this hadith that they are responsible. رَاعِيَةٌ عَلَى بَيْتِ بَعْلِهَا, over the house of her husband. وَوَلَدِهِ, and his children. وَهِيَ مَسْؤُولَةٌ عَنْهُمْ, so she is also responsible. And the وَالْعَبْدُ رَاعٍ عَلَى مَالِ سَيِّدِهِ, means that the employee is responsible over the wealth or the stock and the business of his employer. So even you have employment rights and something mentioned here. So I'm going to go through this very quickly because there's so much to cover. Why did the Prophet ﷺ said "Ala kullukum ra'in"? Why did he choose the word shepherd? Well, first of all, shepherd is the mihna, it is the job of the prophets. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala specifically chose people who were shepherds. And the reason is, there's so many, you know, the ulama, they discuss this. It's in Fathul Bari, it discusses. One of them is that the stock that they're dealing with is not theirs. They don't deal with their own flock. They're taking care of their ri'aya, their cattle, of someone else the way he wants it dealt with. So the first message here is that the children are not your property. Our children are not our property, brothers and sisters. They have a soul just like ours. They are not yours to do whatever you want with them. You manage them in the way your Rabb told you to deal with them. Just like a shepherd deals with the stock of his master or the owner. The second thing is, the shepherd has two major roles that the deen itself is encapsulated by. The sharia is encapsulated by, which is nurturing, building, imbibing, and hudud, limiting. This is Islam. That's the whole of Islam. Islam does only two things. It imbibes, it tries to put something in you, nurture something, and it makes the limit so you don't go past a certain limit. That's parenting, basically. That's good governance, and that's good parenting. So Islam, that's what it basically means. And as I've mentioned, the mas'ul will be answerable on the Day of Judgment. So when it says, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he said, kullu rajulin, min al-muslimina ala thagratin min thugharil Islam. Allah la yu'tal Islamu min qibalik. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, ruwiya anhu, it was said that every single one, kullu rajulin, meaning, you know, you might think it's someone else's job. If I say, hey, all the Muslims, oh, you mean they're Muslims? No, you Muslim. Every single Muslim. He is ala thagratin min thugharil Islam. What does thagra mean? Thagra means gap, a breach. You know, so imagine the picture, subhanAllah, when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, u'titu bi jawami al-kalim. He said, when I have been given the clear and concise speech, boy, he meant it. Look at the imagery drawn straight away. The Islam is a fortress. It's a fortress, and he has, you know, like in Mecca, you have all the gates, gate number, like this. It's surrounded by gates. Every single one of you, ala thagratin min thugharil Islam, you are all on one of the, guarding one of the entrances to the gates. What do you keep inside your fortress? Anyone watch Lord of the Rings and manage to stay through the whole 3 hours? What's in the fortress? Everything special to the Muslims. Everything we hold dear. Isn't it? Our children, our women, our wealth, our honor, our sanctity, our security. So all of these things, the ibadah, to be able to, the freedom to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, all of those things are in the fortress. And every single one of you are a guard at one of those breaches. Allah, it says Allah, just Allah. They say that there's a sentence that is mahzuf, or that is assumed. It's assumed that it means, by Allah, it better not be you. That's what it means, by Allah. لا يؤتى الإسلام من قبلك. It ain't the case. I hope it ain't the case, by Allah, that Islam is entered upon by your qibalik. You know the word qibla, so you've got a feeling, meaning by your direction. I pray to Allah that Islam is not entered by your direction, by the gate that you are covering. So you can see that this amana is big, my brothers and sisters, and parenting is one of those gates. Now, it mentions the parents, so I'm going to be dealing with the parents, the mothers and the fathers in general, and then we're going to get into some very nitty-gritty details. So far I'm just trying to build around the subject so you get an idea, the emphasis of what I'm trying to point out. When it says الرجل راع على أهل بيته وهو مسؤول عنهم والمرأة راعية على بيت بعلها وولده وهي مسؤولة عنهم, it is saying that this is detailing the role of the parents. Think about especially the mothers in this instance. I have to put a special emphasis on the mothers. If you could look at the life of Imam Bukhari, if you look at it, he had a single mother. He was raised just by his mother. People like him, his fathers had died early. The mother of Imam Shafi'i was a single mother. The mother of Anas bin Malik was also a single mother. Think about it, he's just a mother. Forget the dad, what effect he had. He is not even there. We're talking about just the role of what kind of powerhouses the mothers of Islam have brought to this world. And the mother of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. You know, she lived longer and was around the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam far greater than the period of time his father was around, dying near his birth. So subhanAllah, look at this. Look at these great people that came from mothers, from single mothers, not even with the help of a father. But today, if you look at a single mother, or just a mother, to be honest, it's looked at as a mother who's struggling, to raise her children. She's struggling to make ends meet. She is forced to go to work. She's seen to be scrounging off the government if she's trying to raise children. Isn't it? They will give you, I recently had a kid, so you go to the final checkup from the midwife and they say, do you want to go to work? You want to go to work? We'll let you have creche. So you'll have a creche, you'll pay someone to take care of my child while then she goes to work. The same amount of the money that the person is getting paid to take care of the creche. SubhanAllah, Allahu Akbar. If this is not insanity, I don't know what is. So women are not appreciated in the society as mothers. They're told that, you're really scrounging off the system, or you shouldn't really do anything at home. Umar ibn al-Khattab was the first person to institute, isn't it, the welfare, the child benefit for weaning the children, for providing for the children, to have strong and healthy children. That the mothers are given it, even if they don't wean it. He actually retracted that law, and then he made it that everybody, whether they wean their children or not, whether they provide their children milk or not, they get their child benefit. This is what Islam and the honor it gave to men and women, and the responsibility, the fact that he put money down to invest in children, not put them in, spend the money on the prison after, and the social worker, and the social housing, and all of these things. It tried to solve these things from the best place you could nurture and solve problems, which is before they happen, which is within the family. So, moving on, now I'm going to give you various bits of advice about how we deal with our parents, or rather how parents deal with their children. Though I will be focusing, actually, it might be painful at times, because I'm going to have a go at the parents a bit. But really we need to look at our children and realize that from the onset that our children are blank canvases. Our children are ma'soom. They don't, at that age when they're born, they don't have no mistakes, they have no sin. When the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Kullu mauludin yuladu ala al-fitrah," that every single believer is born upon the fitrah, the natural disposition. The natural disposition. What is the natural disposition? To link causes with effects, and hence maybe to think that there's a single cause for many effects that have one cause, that have a finite number of causes maybe. Maybe a two-year-old isn't thinking that. But the fitrah is generally that he thinks there is an affinity to God, there is affinity to good and bad, and to morals and values, to learn from his environment. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "No, but it's the parents that make him a Christian, Zoroastrian, or a Jew." Meaning that the children that are given to us are blank slates. You know, some people say about the kids, "He's just bad. This is the bad one. Don't worry about him." He just came like that. They don't come like that. Okay, so that's the first thing to prove that there's a blank canvas. The second point I want to point out is that we don't look at the environment that our children are around and how that affects their upbringing. We don't look at the fact that they are looking at us and taking the cues. You know, one of the evidences the scholar said why taqleed is allowed, because they said it's a human instinct. The main thing at the beginning a human does is he does taqleed. When he's born, how does he learn to speak? How does he attribute sounds and words, laugh, to meanings? By seeing someone else do that. This is how a human being naturally, how he grows. In that environment, we need to look at what are we placing in front of our children that influence them? What habits are we giving them? Because I tell you one thing, my brothers and sisters, anyone who's had a child recently, or anyone who can recall when they had their child, the amount of effort I see parents go through in making sure that child is fed. Some use syringes. There you go. This is your baby food. All right? They do all sorts of things to make their children well fed, to have an able body. You take them to all of the appointments for all of the vaccinations. Brothers, this is for us who believe in Al-Akhirah, this is badness. We care more for their bodies that will perish than their soul which will remain in Al-Akhirah. How does that make sense? How much money do you spend on feeding them and clothing them and the Nike trainers that are that big, you know, that last for how long? But when it comes to teaching them about their Akhirah, they're linking this life to Al-Akhirah, we pay no attention at all. You're trying to preserve a body that perishes from the day it was born. It doesn't make sense, my brothers and sisters. That's why one of the first advice I will give is that every child, you should develop them as a default position as a student. Every child that is born should be eager to learn the knowledge of Islam, eager to learn about his deen and to learn and explain the situation around him. Was it not Yusuf alayhi salam who asked his father, and he said to him, "O father, I have seen the celestial bodies do sajda towards me." I mean, if your son said something like that to you, if our children said anything profound like that, isn't you be watching too much cartoons, get out. You would even ignore him, you probably would not notice it. Yes, 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 son. But he was paid attention to. And this is what we need to really think about, that we really need to be careful in how we raise our children, and the first and foremost, since they are born learners, that you should teach them how to be students. Ibn Taymiyyah is something I was taught by my teacher. Ibn Taymiyyah, he was taught this, you know, they teach them as young kids. They say, Al-Muslimu kayyisun, fatinun mutaharrikun, laysa mutaqawqi'an, balidi dhihni kaslan al-badani. This is like a motto for children, yeah? You can give it to your children in English, you can give it in Arabic, you can give it anyhow. Ibn Taymiyyah, he was taught, and his teacher and so on, they were taught that the Muslim is kayyisun fatinun mutaharrikun. He is kayyisun, he's smart. He's sharp. The Prophet ﷺ said, Al-kayyis man dana nafsahu. The smart one, the intelligent one, is the one who accounts himself and questions his role and questions his responsibilities. Wal-ajiz, the dumb one, the dumbo, he says, is the one who disobeys Allah and then he hopes for Allah's mercy. You know, he does sin, he doesn't think about it, he doesn't think, and then he just hopes for Allah's mercy. Tamanna ala Allah. He does just, you know, the tamanna means like a hope that doesn't really have any kind of, it doesn't reach an end, you know, it just hope for the sake of hope. So he said that the Muslim is smart and intelligent, you know, courteous and tactful. You know, part of intelligence is adab. Did you know that? Many Muslims today, I hear around some brothers, they tell me that every Muslim is a statesman and politician. He understands his relationship between people before he has met them. This is what all the Muslims were. This is how the Prophet ﷺ taught in Darul Arkam the Muslims. This means adab. You don't go to the Imam and go, "All right, pal, how's it going?" After that, you can show him all the ihtiram and respect you can. It's all over. You don't know who you're talking to. You don't know who you're dealing with. A part of intelligence is to know before you arrive at something what that thing is, to think about it before you act. So it's to be sharp and to be tactful. Many children nowadays, you know, and I run various things for kids of various ages, from my Quran initiative to other things. You talk to a kid and you say, "Excuse me," and the kid goes, "Huh?" That's his response. Huh? Is this what we've come to, my brothers and sisters? We've come to, like, we're human beings, you know, animals make noises. The child, that's his response. Not, sorry, what did you say? What uncle or what ustad? No. This is the kind of, so this is not, we shouldn't be like this, we should be kayyis. Fatinun mutaharrikun. Fatin means brain, brains. Yeah, in Bengali, mogos. Yeah? Brains, mutaharrik. Mutaharrik, you know, you use it when you talk about, like, you know, muharrik means engine, like, you know, engine in a, you know, in a steam engine like this. It means he's got a brain that's always, it's buzzing, it's moving. I swear this is another problem. Children start off very, very intelligent, very, very, like, interested about everything. They question everything. The ones who do dampen their mind and make them stupid is actually the parents. They don't entertain that idea. They just put him in front of the TV. Just sedate this kid. You might as well not get the TV, you might as well just inject him. And just put him to sleep so he doesn't bother you in your life that you're trying to live. Once you have children, my brothers and sisters, your life takes a secondary role. Your marriage and your husband and your wife role takes a secondary role. Your children then come first. You live for your children. This is how the Muslims are. Because he knows he's raising the next citizen, the next believer and member of society. And he will spoil and ruin that based on how he deals with things in the home. Laysa mutaqawqi'an. It's a very, very, very strange statement. Laysa mutaqawqi'an. Not with shell. Some of you might be thinking Ninja Turtles. Yeah? Not with shell means that he travels light. You teach your children to travel light. You know, as a lot of elders, you know, like, because with shell means an animal that like a snail, it carries its shell, it carries its home around with him. And they say that whoever has a lot of possessions will slow him down in succeeding as a believer, because his dunya is dragging him back and slowing him down. He wants to come to a circle, but he has to work on the evenings a bit more. He works in the city, but he does cabbing on the weekend to pay for his lovely house. He says, I want to come to the circle. The house says, no, go to work. We wonder who is the owner in this situation. Did the house got a mortgage on you, on your life, or you got a mortgage on the house? Laysa mutaqawqi'an. So you teach your children to travel light, meaning that they're not dependent on a million things. If I don't have every single gadget thing and game and this and that, I can't do anything. You give them a book, you give them some slices of carrots and a bowl, you sit them down. I know you sound like a pet today. Maybe that's because we're treating pets too well, right? But and you say read. You teach them to read and then you give them the opportunity to have that time. Balid al-dhihni. Laysa balid al-dhihni. So not Balid al-dhihni means slow of mind, dull-witted. Kaslan al-badani, and slow of body, laziness of body. So these are the two things we institute in our children as students, and these are the two things we avoid. Slow mind, yeah, and a sluggish body. You know, children, you know, they've got so much energy. But what makes them slack and slouch and procrastinate and not get to do what we tell them to do is because they've got this familiarity that when I do things, it doesn't really matter. And this is something that I remember even teaching my son, that when you teach your children, you have to make sure that you show them that every minute task counts. It's not just the salah that counts. Everything you do is a form of worship. Sah? Everything is a form of worship. Everything falls under what we call the khitab al-takleef, the legislative address. Allah has said something about everything. There's a ruling on everything. Even if it's mubah, there's a ruling. That means that with our children, they need to know that even cleaning, even the way they arrange their pens, even the way that they prepare, even the way that they study, everything has a way of doing it, has a proper mechanism of doing it. The hadith, the Prophet ﷺ said, "Inna Allah Ta'ala yuhibbu idha amila ahadukum amalan an yutqinahu." He said, indeed Allah, He loves that when a person does an action, أَنْ يُتْقِنَهُ. He does it بِالْإِتْقَان. He does it with, to إِتْقَان means to do well. Meaning that, well, can you imagine now that washing plates, brothers, washing plates, you know that thing you eat off? Right, now, you know the washing of plates? That's a worship. Allah loves it. If you do it well as well, you know, like, just wash it, the wife washes it again because it's got half the food on the other side. Okay? No. Even if you sweep the floor, that's a worship. You want to do it well. That's one of the things I was taught when I was a kid. We were told to do anything you do well. Subhanallah, now you teach your kid, oh, it's only cleaning up, it's only this, it's only that. Eventually nothing is, it's only salah, it's only reading, it's only learning, it's only tawheed, it's only everything. Because you've given them that lack of seriousness, that meticulous nature and attention to the world around them. To not have that, to do well, to not have itqan means you have no attention to the world around you. So your children are looking at their parents, they're not learning from just your words. If you walk past with your child and you see broken glass on the street, then if you sweep it to the side, that will teach your child 1,000 times more than any lecture you give your son. Kids operate on really movement, on the visual. They understand the visual. So you need to think about how you institute that. Okay, I've got to really speed up. The first thing I want to say that you teach your children through that is ubudiyyah. That you teach them that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is worshipped alone, that He is the reason that you live, He is the purpose for your life, He is the main reason why you exist and why He created you. And He is the one that you were thankful for before you were even created. Many of you, if I pick a brother here, we were thankful before we've even created. We owe Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala thanks. Who put your father and mother there before you were born? Who brought your mother and father? Who brought you into this country? Who from your great-great-grandfather, I'm guessing now, who accepted Islam? Who laid the sky? This is in Imam Shafi's Risala in the introduction, he mentions this. He says, who gave you the sky, the moon, the whole universe prepared for your child to be born, ready before he came? You have to teach your children to be grateful to their Lord. That this is who we attribute thanks. If you had a PlayStation 3 outside your house in a bowl, what would you say of the man who just goes, oh, okay, and he plays it and on his deathbed he's thinking, who gave me that gift? You think this man is a selfish man. Allah gave you all of this. And we don't think about it, we don't question it. We need to teach a relationship that our child has with his Rabb. Second, very quickly now, is the relationship with money. Really, money is one of the most dangerous things and one of the most beneficial things for the dunya. You know, people give their children money is an inevitable thing of the dunya. So you have to build a relationship with money, with them. You have to show them that this is the rizq that Allah has given you, that you're giving them, and that you have to dispense that rizq in a certain way. You know, my dad took me this, it's not I came, you know, when my dad would take me to the masjid, he would give me some money, and then I would put that in the bucket, and I'd have that choice, you know, I could buy sweets with this. And it's like, okay, well, I'll put some in the bucket. So now, you know, I do the same thing with my son, I'd give him some money, and he has a choice now. That's the choice, that's where it matters, where his ideas are in a context where it's tested. And he can keep the money, or he can give it to the masjid, and then he can leave the masjid, and then he thinks, you know what, okay, I'll give the money. If you don't build a relationship with wealth with your children, then they will become, and you say, oh, do this and I'll give you money. Then your children, when they have money, they will be independent of you. Isn't that the case? Isn't it? You tell them, do this because I provide for you. Do this because I pray. Who's the provider? You're not the provider. You say, Allah provides for me and for you. Otherwise, he's going to say, no, dad. Say, you're not going out today. No, dad. I've got a Morrison's badge on. I get £6 an hour, whatever minimum wage is. You know, I'm independent now. You told me because of that money, I don't have the freedom to choose what I do. Well, now I've got my own money and I choose how I spend it. That's it, that's freedom from parents now. You made it a monetary thing. I see so many parents spoiling their children, trying to buy them things and all that. Then what if he just buys his own toys? Buys his own PlayStation, buys his own car. Goes to his own, you know, buys his own cinema tickets and God knows what else. It's all over. You taught your child, can you see this will come from the parent. What does the child know? He knows nothing. He's a blank slate. You teach your child to be a hardcore capitalist. You teach him to just think purely in monetary terms. From the beginning, the day he was born. It's not good, my brothers. The second thing, and these are all I'm just touching on, you can maybe deal with them in the question and answers maybe. Second is diet. Diet is one of the most important things about how we deal with our children. You know, a man came up to Umar ibn al-Khattab and he said to him, you know, Umar ibn al-Khattab, he was outside and he said like, what's this? He just saw this man with a belly, like a round, spherical, like a beautifully round belly, you know? And he's like, what is this? And he said, this is Allah's blessing, this is. And you know, like, I know Asian, you know what I mean. It spans across various countries. We rub the belly and go, oof, mashallah. Allah has blessed me. He said, Allah's cursed you, my brother. Allah's cursed you, really. Allah's cursed you. We need to think about that. He says, this is a punishment from Allah. Let me tell you something about it, about food. If you eat too much, let's just quickly deal with this, because anyone who wants to get anywhere in life, in anything, let me just show you. Time is the greatest commodity. You don't have time is the thing that you actually have a finite amount of. Everything else you can fill, but it fills within pockets of time. Really, when you eat too much, really what happens is that you have to buy more food. It means you have to work more to pay for that food. It means you take longer to prepare the number of meals. You know, the spread, you know? You should just get some food, put it on a plate and eat it. No, we do the spread, you know? It's like options going, you know? And so you spend more time going to the toilet. Naturally, you eat, you go to the toilet more. You have wudu less. How many times have you wanted to read the Quran? You go, I ain't got wudu and I can't get up. You know? You ain't got wudu. You have wudu less. Your instincts are agitated more when you eat more. When you eat too much, more than you need, your instincts are agitated. Those who went hajj would know. You know, I'm here sitting there in ihram like a fool. I've got a big bag of peanuts, you know, with strong saturated fats. You will understand, people who know human male physiology. Heart, like, you know, heavy fats like that are not good, let's just say, in that situation when you're in ihram. You know, I'm sitting there eating them away like that. You know? So you have to think about this. I was going to say that the amount of free mixing that goes in our areas, in our communities, there might be a correlation with the number of chicken and chip shops that are emerging in your area. I suggest someone graph that up and work it out. But there is an attitude towards food. That, you know, because when you eat really, really fatty food, it makes your desires high. What did the Prophet say when you feel you're going to commit zina? He said, fast. It's actually linked to your, also to your physiology, not just the relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So chicken and chips, high fat, sugars, they harm the ability of the believer to concentrate. The greatest gift that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave you was the mind. Was the mind. You know the scholars, they say, al-alatu sharrafat bimaqasidiha. They say that the tools are honored by their usage. Like if you're cleaning out the rubbish, that spade or whatever, you're not going to go home and clean it with fairy liquid. It's just for dirty job, you just use a dirty tool. But if you're a diamond cutter, you know those tools, or if you're a surgeon, those tools, you really love those tools. You keep them clean, those utensils, you keep them precise and clean and sharp. Now the way you understand your deen is through your mind. How do you understand what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling you is through the tool that He gave you, which is the mind. If you spoil the mind, how are you going to understand the deen? The one gift that Allah gave, the ability to concentrate, if you ruin that, that's why kids can't pay attention anymore. Huh? 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 Like that, they're always like this. Their concentration level is gone. Because they're constantly watching TV, which is a passive experience. TV is a passive experience. You are not thinking at all. It's telling you already everything that's going on. You don't have to use your imagination. You know, Pixar done it for you. So really what's happening is you're just literally like that, having a passive experience, and it's just putting images and images and images and images in your head. At least when you read a book, you have to use your imagination to draw up these imagery. So basically we're ruining the mind of our children. If you ruin the mind, if you ruin the tools of knowledge, that's what I'm telling you. Brothers, you might think, what's this brother talking about? He's barking up the wrong... I've dealt with 15 years with youth. Their inability to concentrate is one of the major problems in teaching people their deen. Isn't it? I have to flip him a burger, I have to take him somewhere, I have to do this, I have to do that, I have to play football with him, I have to be his best friend. Anything, just to get him to concentrate for that 30 minutes in that day where I can pass an idea or concept. You know? Why is that? Because the way his parents have brought him up, constantly, you know, agitated, looking for the next thing to distract him. He's talking to you, a car goes by, he has to look at it. He can't help it. Can't concentrate. So we really need to make sure that we deal with this. Umar al-Khattab, it was narrated that he said, "Al-batnu tuthibul al-batna tuthibul fitna." This is a little poem he said. He said, "Overeating takes away tuthibu, removes acumen." You know, so even he understood that at this time that it takes away acumen. The fourth bit of advice. How are we doing for time? I'm already in trouble, I guess. Okay. The fourth. There's not like 10. Don't worry. The fourth is to build a relationship, your child's building him a relationship with the masjid. The masjid, my brothers and sisters, is the sanctuary of the believer. It's when things don't work out with your wife, okay, your kids, your parents or whatever, who's he going to, whose lap is he going to fall into? You know that. A lot of these young brothers with girlfriends, believe me, they've got problems at home, they've got family issues, and they fall in the lap of someone. You understand? Where do they go as their sanctuary? Their sanctuary is the masjid. The Prophet ﷺ, he described the seven who will be given shade on the Day of Judgment, isn't it? Under Allah's arsh. One of them is the child that was practiced Islam when he was young. You know, the one who was given Islam when he was young. So that's one of them. And the other is the one whose heart was tied to the masjid. Correct? I put it to you, brothers, that the former is linked to the latter. That if you want someone to practice young, then you need to build in them and institute them in them a relationship with the masjid. But what do I mean a relationship with the masjid? Go hug a pillar? What do I mean by relationship with the masjid? It means that this is a place for the community to practice and discuss and to think about Islam, and a think tank, a place where you relate to the outside world, to understand what's going on around you. That's what the masjid was always, is always, it was institute of learning. Most of the universities, I was in Al-Azhar, it's a masjid. Okay, they're all masajids. But the emphasis is not just to think that sending him to the masjid and you walk off. You know, I sent him to madrasa. I don't mean that. The Arabs, they say, "Arraq ala sajid, laysa bina al masajid." It's a very nice statement. I love it. They say the emphasis is upon the sajid, laysa bina al masajid, and not building mosques. You need to build the sajid. You need a person. You need to build a child that loves to do prostration to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who wants to do prostration to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Otherwise you can build all the masajids you like. But if you don't build the sajid, what is a sajid? Someone who has humbled himself to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, not just in his sajda, but in all remit of his life, as a solution to all of his problems. That is a true sajid. Not a sajid who does sajda, like in my local mosque, and then he's got fully licensed. There is more alcohol in his sweet shop than sweets. Do you get it? Yeah? Right? But he's like on the first in the row. Do you get my point? I'm not talking about that kind of sajid. A sajid, when he humbles himself and he lowers his mind in submission to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's wahi, that's a sajda. That's what we need to build in our children. Otherwise, if you don't build the sajid, you'll have Somali masjid, you'll have sectarian masjid, you'll have Bengali masjid, you'll have Sileti and Dahai masjid, you'll have Chittagong masjid, you'll have God knows what else masjid, you'll have, you know, the African brothers masjid. Do you get it? You'll have Arab masjid. You'll have every type of masjid because you didn't build the sajid. So we need to make sure that we build the sajid. This is the mindset of a believer that we need to work on. So that's why the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is very beautiful hadith. I have to share it with you. He said, "Aqrabu ma yakunu al-'abdu min rabbihi wa huwa sajid." He said that the closest a servant can be, yeah, min rabbihi, to his Lord, wa huwa sajid, while he is a sajid. That means he should love to be in sajda. They should love to be in sajda. And this is from seeing their parents submit their lives to Islam. Then they would submit their lives to Islam, i.e. to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's commands. And naming your children. This is something, there's a fiqh about this, and I just thought it has some interesting dimensions to it. You know, I find that a lot of brothers, they think the brothers, especially, the parenting is naming them. I've named him. Yeah, I've named him. It's Tariq bin Ziyad. Now go do your job. Okay? Salahuddin Ayyubi, Muhammad Al-Fatih. Brothers, there's no point calling your children Salahuddin, Saifuddin Al-Qutuz if you got your feet up watching The Simpsons. Okay? You can give him the biggest name you want. Let me warn you now. You can give your son the biggest, grandiose name on earth, and he will change it. He'll change his name. All of us know. I'm a khatib in a bank. I meet Mo, I meet Joe, I meet Shaq, I meet Jack. That's Shaquille, that's Muhammad, that's... What happened? That's Jakir. Do you know what happened? Zakir, Jack, he's Jack now. Subhanallah. So you can't just name them and think that you've... That's it. You have to build what Salahuddin Ayyubi had when he was a child. A stratagem, a thinking about how he's going to save this ummah. You need to instill that. But you just name them Salahuddin Ayyubi, son, you're going to be a great man one day. And you know, children, they say this, they just say, yeah, dad. You know what I mean? He's saying that, but he's thinking something else. He's looking at you. So you need to think about that just naming them is not enough. You need to give them the characteristics and the understanding and the thinking of these great men. one of my teachers, he taught me just a priority, just a quick fiqh of naming children. It may not be totally relevant, but I thought it's important. Firstly, the first priority of naming your children is Abdurrahman, is Abd. Is Abdurrahman, Abdullah, something like this, Abdul Qadir, and so on. That's the first best names you can give. The second best names are the names of the prophets, the Anbiya. The third best names you can give are the names of the Sahaba radiallahu anhum. And the fourth priority is that you give your name, son, a name that is just a good meaning. Something that's tayyib, something that's pure, something that's good. Because a lot of the time we name, you know, someone, my sheikh told me, someone came and they said they named the child Sharrayyara, Allah. Na'udhu billah min dhalik. Sharrayyara. You know, whoever does an atom weight of sin or evil on that day, mustard seed, they will see the Sharrayyara. They will see that shar, that complete horrid sin. You tame their children that. Just because it's in the Quran doesn't mean it's a good name. Yeah, there's Fir'aun in there. There's, you know, there's loads of baddies in there. You know, you gotta separate the baddies from the goodies in the Quran. You have to be careful with that. Yeah, and also very quickly, you need to make sure that you build in your children. This is linking to the names really. Is role models. You need to build a relationship with the Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, with your children. They need to know who he is, my brothers and sisters. They need to know the Sahaba radiallahu anhum. They need to intimately know these people. And I'll tell you why. In the West, this is the context we live in. We live. The greatest men that they've ever had in this society, the greatest men, they're comic book heroes. They don't exist. I got Superman when I was a kid. Superman, Spider-Man, the Hulk, Hulk Smash, you know, all of this. These were the heroes, isn't it? These are the heroes. Because really, they don't have any heroes. If you look at Winston Churchill, or you look at Roosevelt, you read their biographies, you find out this man used to dress up as a woman at night, and this guy was like this, and this guy was a racist, and this guy was anti-Semitic, and these guys were horrible people. The ulama, they say that the more you look into the figures in the West, the more you look into, the more you dig, the more ugliness comes out. Oh my God, I like that guy. I used to like that footballer. Now I find out, whoa, I'll just stick to the football, you know? Because you don't want to know his life anymore. But they say that the more you dig into the life of the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, and therefore by greater right, the life of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, there is more fragrance, there's more of a fragrant reality that comes from that. You find out more amazing. The more you dig, the more you find. The more you dig, the more beauty you find. The more you dig in their heroes, Winston Churchill and these people, the more ugliness you find. We have our role models. Why, you know why I'm making this distinction? You show someone Khalid bin Walid, one of the most toughest, most, such a character, such an interesting character, so many dimensions to him. Subhanallah. If you could talk about Khalid bin Walid just as a person who prays and recites Quran, do you know that? You don't think of him like that. Or you could think of him as a statesman, just as a statesman. Or you could think of him as the battlefield. I know the battlefield, right? I know what we're talking about, the battlefield, yes. But all of these things separately is like a genius in these aspects. But guess what? You tell your son about Khalid bin Walid, and you tell him how he jumped over the lines, the saf of the enemies, in the middle and the heart. You want to see that, my brothers and sisters. You want to see how much guts you need to do that. To know to jump into your imminent death. But your son goes, you know, the X-Men, you know, Wolverine's done something a little bit better than that. It's funny, but it's so sad. If we weren't laughing, we should be crying. Who did that? What was my main point before? Us. May Allah forgive us. May Allah forgive us. We did that. We put this thing now, it's not even real. It's a standard that doesn't exist. That's like I said, they need to make super, I mean, if you think about it in reality, what real benefit is there in flying? I can go Biman Airways. Yeah, I can fly with what real talent is there to have X-ray vision? What real value is there in being super strong? This world is a world was made of for ideas. You know, human beings were made, our greatest strength was ideas. The jinns are the ones who are quwwah and strength. We were given brains, they were given the brawn. This world is about ideas, not just about brawn. If you have brawn and no ideas, the guy with the ideas will control your brawn. That's how it works. So what real value is these super, you know, these super powers that they have? They're quite useless. Why do I need to, you know, the Cyclops, you know, toast my bread with my eyes or whatever? What do you need to do this for? I got a toaster. These are silly things to have, isn't it, if you think about it? In reality, to be able to have patience in the most toughest of situations like Bilal radiallahu anhu, to have bravery like Khalid bin Walid, to have that discerning mind, that sharp mind, and such care and thoughtfulness about the ummah of Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu. See what I'm talking about? Those are the things that really, that's superhuman, because he's a human and he's super in those attributes that he's been given. Not x-ray vision and flying and all of that. I don't need these things. They're not practical. They're not useful in this world. Another main point I think is important in instilling in our children is teaching justice. Teaching the importance of that's when they see something wrong, they say that's not right. That you expose your children to some of what's going on in the Muslim world. Not graphic, horrible images. You know, don't destroy your kid's mind. It's only a child. But to have an awareness that there are injustices going on in the world and to feel that, no, this is wrong. This is something that we need to do something about it. Not, don't worry, son, our family's okay. We've got a nice 3-bedroom house. We've got a nice car. You know, that's it, you know. Don't worry, when you're 20, you can move out. I'll build a jacuzzi. You know, some people do these sort of things, yeah? Right? They're not like that. But you have a game plan. Son, what are we going to do? That's what I do. I say, son, what are we going to do about it? We saw it. What are we going to do about it? Why can't you have that conversation? Sadly, my son has better ideas. Or some ulama, they say, there's nothing you can do about it. There's nothing you can do about it. That's the answer. That's the shortest fatwa ever. My son says, what are we going to do about it? And she thinks, you know what? My ideas can reach there. My voice can reach there. My du'as can reach there. My money can reach there. My da'wah can reach there. Our unity can reach there. My son's got ideas. I said, ulama, he's got no ideas. He's brass. He put it out. I got nothing, my friend. He's got no ideas on how to look at this situation. We need to have that conversation with our children. What are we going to do about it, son? Even if it's just what we're going to do about it. You don't have to give him the right answer. Ibn Mas'ud, he was asked, radiallahu anhu, he was asked, who is the living dead? It's a very strange question, I know. Yeah? Right? But he was asked by the companions, he was asked, who is the living dead? He said, الَّذِي يَعْرِفُ مَعْرُوفًا لَا يَعْرِفُ مَعْرُوفًا وَلَا يَنْكُرُ مُنْكَرًا. He said, the one who is the living dead, walking physically, but entire is dead, inside is dead. He said, is the one who never commanded for the good and who never forbade the evil. This is the best Qari of Islam, one of the best of the Qur'an, recitation of the Qur'an, was Ibn Mas'ud. And he said that the one who doesn't enjoin good and forbid the evil is like the living dead. He's a zombie. You know, he doesn't really understand Islam. So, I think I've covered most of the bigger things, some smaller things that I feel are important. We need to look ahead for our children and have a plan of what we want them to be. We need to think about what role should they fulfill in that society? Because if they don't fulfill a role as a da'wah carrier, as a statesman, as a family, as a member, as a parent, as a future, all of these things, then society will attribute to him the meaning of those things. He will have that role. You cannot escape that. That's why the scholars, they said, النظر في العواقب تلقيح للعقول. تلقيح للعقول. They said, النظر في العواقب, to look towards the future consequences, is a vaccination for the mind. Such a wicked statement. Such a wicked, amazing, you know, we say practical principle. We say, you know, we say sense, to sense and be aware, to think about what you've sensed, and then to discern and then deploy action. But you have to simulate that before, isn't it? You don't just get hit by something and then go, oh, should have ducked, you know? A believer, what he does is he prepares his children where he looks at the consequences coming up, and it's like a vaccination. Do you know what vaccinations are? Brothers and sisters, vaccinations are dead cells of the actual disease. It's a strain, a weak strain, and dead cell of the actual disease, you know, that you're being injected with. Why? It's to train the body to know how to deal with that when it really happens. we need to simulate this with our children in terms of discussing Islam, discussing the attacks, you know, evolution and secularism, all the different ideas that will be brought to them in various forms and shapes. We need to discuss these things and prepare our children. Also, because you can't hide them from the world. You have to vaccinate your children in terms of their ideas from this world, just as well as you have to vaccinate their body from the physical ailments and elements in this world. So, really, I'll end with one important thing, is the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he really implored the Muslims to be gentle with their kids. Because I'm telling you now, there has been a shift in parenting, how the reality of parenting. My brothers and sisters, we all had parents, maybe from Indian subcontinent or from abroad, maybe second generation Muslims, maybe third, looking around, maybe third generation Muslims. You know, our dads were like, you know, samurai, you know? What do you think, Dad? I could translate that as so many things, you know. I'm proud of you, son, go and do this. No, it's nothing. It's like, you could just have a grunt and it would. I'd have to interpret that, okay? Those days are gone, okay? Our dads were busy working left, right, and trying to make ends meet, doing a lot of things. Those days are gone. You have time, you have wealth, you have money. Don't exchange that for fanciful dreams about this big house and big car and all of that and forget your children. Don't forget your children. Really, what you need to do is you need to think about how you have to have a proper, loving relationship with your children, the fathers. You cannot be a samurai, you know, honor, you know. I said, you know, and the child just somehow infers some wisdom, you know, Mr. Miyagi style. Yeah, no, none of that. You have to have a relationship with your son. Because if you don't, he will seek someone else for advice, and that person most likely will not be helpful. I can assure you. You should be the one he should think I go to. If you're not that, you've failed as a father. He's the one he should think he can go to ask those questions. Why shouldn't he? You are his world. When he's born, the father and the mother, in different aspects of life, you are their world. Why would they go to someone else? Because of the neglect that we have put in that. And that's why the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Inna Allah rafiqun yuhibbu rifq fi kulli amr." Indeed, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is rafiq. He is gentle, you know, this is latif, you know, this is soft. He is gentle and he loves gentleness in all things. Nothing ever ruined a thing when gentleness was applied to it. And much things were ruined when harshness was attributed to it. That's why look at the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, how gentle he was with the kids. He would interrupt his salah. His salah, he would cut the salah short because he heard children crying. When Hassan and Hussein were there, he would put them on his shoulder. You know, the spiritual bubble now is like, I'm in a religious mode, I have to care. But now, you have religious people not, you know, this whole purify yourself, it doesn't even extend to their children anymore. Now it's just me, nafsi. Ananiya, just care about me. And they forget their children. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would interrupt the prayer and shorten it, speed it up, do all sorts of things. He would pick them and put them up on his shoulder. One time he was doing sajda, and he stayed there for ages, like ages, right? And the Sahaba, radiallahu anhu, they came and said, Wahi, right? It's wahi. You got revelation. That's why you were there for ages. He's getting this long ayat. And he said, no, there was a kid. He was on my back. I just wanted him to fulfill his need, you know. He just wanted to ride. He finished his ride. I waited and then I let him go. Look at the gentleness. I implore you, my brothers, I beg you, especially the parents, especially the fathers, we need to be gentle with our kids. We're not scared the living daylight out of them. Blow their minds out with just pure fear. We're going to send them away from us. We're going to turn them away from us. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, there was this child called Abu Umair, and he used to have, it was a bird, but they used to call it the Nughair, mean nightingale, a bird. And he used to play with this bird, like often you see back home, you know, they try string to the leg of the bird, and they play with the bird. And his bird died. Here's the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam with all his important mas'uliyin, all his important sahabas, da'wah carriers, busy people, world domination. It's important. Don't put back that issue. That's the reason why we're in this mess. He stops and he says, "Ya Aba Umair, ma fa'ala an-Nughair." He even says it in a poetic form. He's, "Ya Aba Umair, ma fa'ala an-Nughair." He said, Umair, what happened to the bird, Nughair? What happened, man? And the kid started crying. It's not his kid, my brothers. This is because the Prophet ﷺ knew what it was like to be abandoned, to be insignificant. No one wanted to take him. The Bedouins did not want to take him. It was a sign given, isn't it? But before that, no one wanted to take the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They didn't want to take him, my brothers. Because he's called, you know, when you have only a mother, no father, it's called yatim. In Islam, no father means yatim, you're orphan. Mother was alive, but no one would take him because this yatim, no father, no money, no income. We can't get paid to take him away for 3 years and to train him in the desert, in the arid desert, to make, give him immunization and weaning and all of these things. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he was insignificant to everybody at a time. Passed on from parent to person, handed out. Here you go, here you go. From the, someone who is so insignificant, in the end, my brothers, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made him a necessary being of this world. He made him a necessary. This world doesn't count anymore without Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It does not count. He made him a necessary being of this world, of this universe. So we see that when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, very important tasks. Yeah, he doesn't forget the little guy. It's this little guy especially. He says, what happened to your bird? The kid starts crying. He leaves the Sahaba, just starts playing with the kid for quite, spend some time with him. We don't even do that with our own children. Don't tell me we're more busy than the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, please. Think about these things, my brothers. I'm going to mention three don'ts, yeah, because I said a lot of do's. Just quick three don'ts. Really, this is Quranic, yeah. This is not. Most of the time, I've taken my voice out of this. I'm just leaving what the Quran, you know, the evidences say. It's the three don'ts in the Quran are ana, the three big vices. Ana, wali, wa indi. Me, yeah. Wali, mine, wa indi, because of me. Because of me. These are the three major, these are the three major vices. Why? Because who said ana first? Kids should not like to say ana a lot. Me, I, mine. Initially, it's inbred in a child is his survival instinct to secure his survival, isn't it? He'll cry when he needs milk from his mother. But when he gets older, you know, he has to realize that you don't just grab things. Just because you grab something doesn't mean it's yours. He needs to honor this anania. This is called individualism. The first person to start off individualism was Shaitan himself. The accursed, ar-rajim. He was the first one who was, he said, ana. He said, ana khayru minhu, sah. He said, I am better than he. I am better than him. The ana, it's a bad word. Me, mine, I, because of me. We need to eradicate these things from our children. Get the I out of it. This was one of the problems. With that, one of the treatments is you need to build a sincerity and you need to build humbleness. Now you need to have strong niyyah. You know, when we say innama al-amalu bin niyyat wa innama likulli imrin ma nawa, or the other hadith yub'athuna ala niyyatihim, when it talks about how the believer is raised on his intentions, that they have to have pure intentions. That's why Imam Ali said that if you don't deal with the intentions of your children, you know, a lot of us like to treat our children like Russian chess champions. I think you know what I'm talking about. We teach them every ayah and this and that and everything and we're cramming them. You know, we're trying to put loads of knowledge. You know, the knowledge, you know, cram the knowledge. We're trying to get them to have this knowledge. And really, we're not changing the state of their hearts. We're not making them sincere people. We're not building an honest person. We're just building someone with loads of information in his head. Imam Ali, you know, he said, if you don't deal with the intentions of your children, he said, the pretense only gets harder to maintain. That's a mad line, honestly. It's a very short line. The pretense gets only harder to maintain. Think about it. If you're not really into it, what your dad and mama into it about this deen, it's very hard to keep going. Keep it. It's harder and harder to keep that fakeness going. To keep doing it because of them and not for you, not for Allah. It's very hard, isn't it? The pretense just builds up and builds up, and then they explode. And that's where I come in. I come in my youth dawah, I have to go, all right, brother, what happened? You know, and we have to deal with this. But then I realize it's because of this. You know, the amount of pressure that we put on our children. We need the humbleness, you know, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam ruwiya anhu, he said, man tawada'a lillahi rafa'ahu Allah, rafa'ahu Allah. The one who humbles himself for the sake of Allah, lillah, rafa'ahu Allah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will raise him. our raising of our rank in this ummah, in this society, and in this world, in this life, is based on tawada, for us to humble ourselves and lower ourselves and accept that we don't know what's good for us, to accept that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala determines the course of our lives, to submit our lives to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in how we live as families, individuals, and societies, and as an ummah. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَآخِرَةُ خَيْرٌ وَأَبْقَى, that the akhirah, in Surah Al-A'la, he says the akhirah is khayrun, is better, وَأَبْقَى, and lasting. Whenever you look at a quality of a thing, what do you establish? How long is it going to last? And its quality. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, yeah, but the akhirah, what's waiting for you after, is better and lasting. Why wouldn't you want that? So we need to think about that. And that's why, that's the first point. Just quickly, li, this thing of mine, it's mine. Who was the person to say that in the Quran? Who said li? Mine. It's all mine. It was Fir'aun who said that. Fir'aun, he said that. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. He says, Ya qawmi, alaysa li mulku misra wa hadhihi al-anharu tajri min tahti. You know, isn't this land mine? Isn't this all mine? And rivers go underneath me. Tajri, you know, min tahti. It's all mine. Li. You know, kids, they love saying mine, mine. We need to make sure that we don't build greedy children. We need to give children things, but not because he was greedy. When he's greedy, you to teach him that you can't have everything in this world. Number, that's probably my major point. I swear the amount of times, I'm just going to be on the level, the amount of times I've dealt with brothers that they're just not used to getting what they wanted. They didn't get what they wanted in life. And then they just leave Islam. You have to get used to it, my brothers and sisters. Yeah, just know you don't get everything you want. You know, this greed that people have, they throw the whole deen away because they want to buy a house, or they want to marry this person, or they want to do, they throw the whole deen away. So they need to be taught that, you know, not to be like small tiny tyrants, you know, Fir'aun, little Fir'auns, always saying, this is mine, this is mine. You need to inculcate your children to learn how to share their food and the things that they care most about. This is what will ascend them from their, just their instincts, this, the resemblance that we have to animals, which is just pure instinctual level. But when I share something, then this raises me in my intellect. This is mentioned in a book called At-Tafkir. It says that when two people, they could fight over the bread and you take half and I take half. But we were both animals. Isn't it? Hayawan. You know, we acted on instincts. We fought each other. Isn't it? That's basically what American foreign policy is, isn't it? You got something that we need for our survival. My piece of bread is mine. And I'll kill you before I can have it. You know, this is how it is, isn't it? Kill you first, so then I don't have to, when I eat it, worry about you wanting it back. Pure instinct. That's what foreign policy, this is where it comes from. Where us, believers, we believe, I got the bread, I found it. I give you half so that not for you to, or I give you, in the book it says, I give you the whole, and then he gives me back half. What's the sum total? Both got the bread. But we ascended as believers, as human beings, because we raised in our intellect, we rose above our you know, instincts, our animalistic instincts. You know? I'll move on, I can't mention everything. And the last don't, I would say, is indi. When your child does something like memorize something or thinks he's good, anything means like because of me, you know? They shouldn't think that. If there's something bad, they take ownership and responsibility over it. If there's something good, they put it to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They say, Allah did it. Thank Allah, Allah made me good, alhamdulillah. Kids can say that. Allah made you good, boy, alhamdulillah. But you put it to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, not to yourself. You know, you don't attribute the goodness to yourself. Why? Because Qanun, he said that. He said, قَالَ إِنَّمَا أُوتِيتُ عَلَىٰ عِلْمٍ عِنْدِي. He said, all of this dominion you see before you, it's because of me. It was because I'm clever, I'm powerful. We know what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did to him. So I end, brothers, so that I can open it up. Forgive me for making this maybe a bit strenuous, and I hope that I haven't offended anyone. I hope that I've maybe created more warmth than I have heat. And that you think about some of the things that I've said. But I wanted to just finalize and put it into context. The first part of that hadith that I mentioned at the beginning was فَالْأَمِيرُ الَّذِي عَلَى النَّاسِ رَاعٍ وَهُوَ مَسْؤُولٌ عَنْهُمْ. The Amir, of which is the responsible over the Ra'in upon an-nas, he is مَسْؤُولٌ عَنْهُمْ. Do you know why, brothers? Because in Islam, political thinking, it exists within all aspects, whether it's your children, your family, your wife, your community, your ummah. When the Prophet ﷺ said, رُوِيَ عَنْهُ كَانَتْ بَنُو إِسْرَائِيلِ تَسُوسُهُمُ الْأَنْبِيَاءِ. He said that the You know, whenever in Arab culture, some Arabs maybe hopefully here, you know, when you say, what do you say if a person's engineer? You say, Al Muhandis Sheikh Khalid, isn't it? You say, Al Muhandis Sheikh, you say, you give his job title, or doctor, we say that in even the UK, Dr. Malik, Dr. something, right? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has mentioned awwalul mihna, the first and foremost pinnacle of the jobs of the anbiya. What was it? Tasusuhumul anbiya. Sasa yasusu siyasatan. As-siyasa. That the job that they did was politics. Am I making this up? I did some, you know, I didn't go to the Googleations. Yeah, I researched this, you know, I studied the tafsir of it. Various tafsir, and one of them, even you could check, you know what we call Lisan al-Arab, you know the dictionary of the source words, you know, of what they mean. If you go and check what it means when it says siyasa, politics, guess what it says? It says ri'aya. It says shepherding. Yeah, governance is good shepherding. And then I checked ri'aya, and it said who was a sassy, meaning the politician. So you check the definition for one, you find the definition for the other. You find the definition for the shepherd or the parent or any of this, you find the definition of a politician. This is in Lisan al-Arab. You know, I had this big blown up copy that I wanted to show you, but forgot it. So this is basically showing you that really as Muslims, we cannot deal with our children isolated from the situation of the world. Every child was born to be something of value to the world at that time. At that time. So you need to think about what is the tasks that lay ahead of the Muslim Ummah and the roles in which that our child plays in that, that he participates in that he benefits and brings a benefit to this Ummah and not just, you know, really a burden on the Ummah. So I ask you to, you know, to kind of think about these things, and inshallah we'll open it up for questions. Jazakallah khair for listening. Qulu qawli hadha wa astaghfirullahal azim.